Rachel went to the women's group and it was amazing. So we'll get that more out to you guys when that happens. Take full advantage of it. It was really great. But we had a great refreshing weekend. Just want to thank the ladies for holding the houses down, the wives, hands. Yeah, amen. Thank you. So praise God. All right, so there we go. Okay, so we're going to start just with tithes and offerings. I have a verse for you from 1 Corinthians 16, 1 and 2. Now, in the New Testament, you're under no obligation to tithe. It's not there. It's a free will offering. But there is a principle of tithing that actually can benefit your life. And that came not in the law, but actually you see it first in Abraham. And so Abraham gave a tenth of all he won in battle and spoils. And we hear that God loaded him up later. And he wasn't there to get rich. He really wasn't. He was there to partner with God. But when you partner with God, guess what he does? He blesses you. Didn't he say, if you leave everything for my sake, homes, land, all this stuff, I'll give you the same hundredfold in this life and in the age to come, eternal life. So it's just his will. That's who he is. So there's nothing you can give up for him without him giving even better something back and more. That's just the person we're walking with. That's the God we're walking with. So this is the verse. It says this. This is Paul. But even in our time, it's like the Lord's allowed some need to exist in the churches so we can learn to love each other as well. And so it's what they call the collection of saints occurred. So this is 1 Corinthians 16, 1 and 2. Now concerning the collection of the saints, as I have given orders to the churches of Galatia, so you must do also. On the first day of the week, let each one of you lay something aside, storing up as he may prosper, that there may be no collections when I come. So he's going to take an offering back to Jerusalem that was needing some support. And he was gathering these offerings from a free will people within the people in these churches to give. And he's saying, get this ready before I even show up. I don't want to come up there and say, hey, give now. Get it in your lifestyle to be abundant and to be generous, not just with your house, but with the houses of other people's needs. So we've taken up, even in this place, offerings for different places and different houses. And we're going to continue to do that. We want to bless where the people of God have need. And it comes through us. You know, I'm not asking you to do it. I'm with you guys in this. I'm giving too. So anyway, we'll just go ahead and take an offering right now. And we're going to bless that. So if you have tithes and offerings or whatever you want to give this morning, why don't you come on up and just put it here. And then I'm going to pray over that. We'll just take a minute to do that. Amen. All right. There we go. Come on. And this is, practically speaking, how we support a lot of the stuff just to keep this ministry kind of going is through the tithes and offerings generosity of you guys. So if you have any questions about how the finance flows here, we'd love to give that. It's an open book. We just want you guys to be in the know. Thank you. Thank you, brother. Come on up. So be ready as you give. Know that you're not just giving something away. You're actually sowing a seed. Amen. And the Lord is going to bless you. He's going to open the windows of heaven. That's Malachi 3. Not my idea. I wouldn't be smart enough to come up with something like that. but it sounds great. But that's his principle. So you cannot give to God and not him come back. So just watch. I want you to be watchful to that blessing. So let's just stretch forth our hands and bless this offering. Father, I thank you so much. Come on up, brother. Put it in here. We thank you so much for this ability to give, Lord. In heaven, there will be no need. Father, but today there's a need to bless the things on earth, to bless our brothers and sisters, to care for one another, to give to one another, and part of that is finance. So Lord, I thank you for those who have sown their treasure here today, their financial gifts. Lord, and I pray you to open the windows of heaven over each one in Jesus' name. And I pray, God, that as blessings begin to overtake them, because that's what you are, that's what you do, that they would acknowledge it's coming from you. And that we would say, Lord, you have surely blessed me today. You have ambushed me with a miracle, a financial blessing, something just to say I love you and that I've seen you tithe, I've seen you give to me, and I cannot be outgiven. So thank you, Lord. We love you. We bless this offering. We pray debt cancellation, all that stuff, all the miracles, breakthrough, whatever people need, Lord, to get their lives aright and just walk in fully in the purposes of God for them. In Jesus' name, amen. Hallelujah. Okay, guys. Thank you. Praise the Lord. Come on up. I was going to grab it. Thank you. Okay, so here we go. This is a message on vision and faith. Now, it's awesome when we get saved. It comes with a moment of vision and promise. You know, if Paul said, if I were to do all the things I do and they weren't true, I'd be the most pitiful of all people. You know? He's like, I'm going radical for this gospel. I'm living with everything I got to glorify Jesus in me and through me. And yet there is this risk. If it's not real, I'll be foolish. I've lived the worst life. But you know what? I'm so on fire. I'm so convinced on the one in whom I've believed and have such promise. I'm running for the high calling. It's not even like I don't know what I'm running for. I'm just running with all my heart. No, I understand there's a high calling involved here. And I'm going to go for it. And what's stored up for me in heaven is a crown of righteousness. a crown of life. I'm running for reward. And he commends us to run in such a way that you'll receive the prize. That's straight up gospel of Paul. That's what he's preaching. So he's challenged us not just to get saved and make this decision for God, but then to figure out what you're here for. What have you been apprehended for? And go for it with all of your heart, with all of your might. And you'll reap in this age, and in the age to come, eternal life and things way beyond your understanding. God can't even break it down right now for us. So it's with great, great grace and great commending and blessing that we run hard and receive that reward. It's by faith, though. So we're going to look at Genesis 12, 1 through 4. This is Abraham. He is the father of faith, right? That's what we say. And he has an amazing encounter and a beginning in the Lord. He is, I forget how many generations from Noah, but he is found in the land of Ur, the Chaldeans, and God visits him. And he begins to speak to him, and he gives him a promise. He says, not only do I want you to believe on me, I want to tell you where I'm going to take you. So let's hear the story real quick, and we're going to pull four keys out of this. When God comes and shows up at our door and begins to speak to us with promise and blessing. Now the Lord had said to Abram, get out of your country, from your family, and from your father's house, to a land that I will show you. I will make you a great nation. I will bless you and make your name great. And you shall be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and I will curse him who curses you. And in you, all the families of the earth shall be blessed. So Abram departed as the Lord had spoken to him, and Lot went with him. And Abram was 75 years old when he departed from Haran. Now, not all of you are going to get this word at 75 years old, okay? Some of you are already on a promise. But I believe this little story, this depiction is here to teach us. Not only can God give you a promise and a calling when you get saved, but he'll give you promises as you're saved. And things are there in place. He's setting in motion to take you into that promise. That's how God is. He's a good father. He's not just father. He's a good father to give you good promises, to take you into good places, fertile lands, right? So when we're studying this, there's four things that speak when you study just the simple calling of Abraham. And this can repeat throughout the word on different men and women of God. You can find this pattern with God because he's the same today, yesterday, tomorrow, and forever. So here's the first one that we want to look at. Four lessons for us from Abraham's calling in God. First one, when God calls, it will usually cost us our present circumstances and routines. No doubt about it. Peter could have kept on going in his fishing business. And man, he just did really well all of a sudden. The temptation to stay and remain in that mindset. In that realm, God just would have been huge. But instead, he says, I choose to drop my nets. I'm going to follow the Lamb. I'm going to follow Jesus. And I'm going to get out of my present circumstances for 3.5 years. I don't even know if he ever goes back to fishing. He becomes a fisher of men. But God's promise is, follow me and I'll make you a fisher of men. But it's going to cost you to leave your lands, your familiarity, your family, all these things that I can do this promise for you. So that's the first thing we see with Abraham's life. Come out of your father's house. And I will bless you. You've got to leave. You've got to leave the routine that you've been in. So calling comes with that. It will cost present circumstances and routines. Number two, when God calls, he often gives a life promise or a vision in the same moment. Okay? So some of you guys are resting on a promise from the Lord. What's that sound like? What's that feel like? I don't know. That's for you. We each have our own thing. There's something deep inside your heart. Maybe it's to change a nation. That's your destiny. When I see me with God, what's that going to look like when I go forward? What's the deep calling into deep? What do I imagine? That I'll be just walk down the street with joy? That's a huge, great dream. But maybe there's more. What is the deep inside your heart? What is that deep vision? You know, God went directly to that in Abraham. He was 75, right? Childless. In that culture, kids were desired like crazy. That's why Jacob has 12. Abraham, I don't know how many had, like 7 eventually. But here's the thing. He had no child. And I love it because God comes right on the heart issue right there. Bam. I know what you desire. And not only am I going to give you a father, I'm going to make you a father of many nations. So God speaks when he calls the promise. It can be way beyond what we think we deserve, what we think God would want to do with us. That's a battle of faith right there. Can you accept it? Can you believe on it? Let him blow your box a little bit. So he gives a promise, the life promise, okay? Number three, when God calls, he provides his protection and oversight as we follow the vision unto completion. One of the first things he told Jeremiah as he started his prophetic ministry, he said, don't be afraid of the people. I will deliver you. But you will say what I tell you to say. When he called Abraham, I'll make you great, and I'll bless those who bless you, and I will curse those who curse you. I'm with you in this. Because when I speak a word, this is the Lord, I see it to completion. I am not a man that I lie. And I'll move all of creation, everything to back that up. So can you trust me when you go through the trials and the tribulations that I'm going to continue with you? Because you will be tested. We're going to talk about that in a moment. So he'll provide the protection and the oversight as they follow the vision to completion. But the first step, again, is stepping out and trusting God when you may not see how he could protect you or how he could provide for you. Number four, final one. This is all pulled out of Abraham's calling from God. When God calls, he purposes to bless many others beyond yourself or beyond ourself. So the calling of the Lord on your life is not just for you to make you great. By you becoming great and accepting the call of God on your life, you're going to liberate thousands around you, if not millions. The call of Abraham was not just to have a kid. It was to father many nations. In fact, Paul comes back on that in Galatians and says, in his seed, the promise was, I will bless all the families of the world, not just yours. So God blesses us to be a blessing is a real statement. It's real true. So you contending for your promise is taking a nation with you. When you continue to endure with the Lord, you get through the testing, it's going to bring thousands with you if you can hang on to it. Okay? The next one here we're going to talk about is the test of time. So we get the promise. We're excited about it. We move out in faith. God, I see what you're doing. I believe it. I'm praying. I'm fasting. I'm contending. I'm keeping my eyes on the prize. If I stumble in doubt for a moment, I let you rebuke me and I get back up. And I say, forgive me, and I get moving again. And that might happen a lot as I'm waiting on this promise because it can take a long time. When's it going to happen? When's it going to show up, all these words over my life? You know? How's that happen? And you'll be tried in that. Some of you are tried in that right now. But if God were to visit you again, he'd remind you exactly of what he said. He says, I am with you. I'll never leave you nor forsake you. I promised you. Will you trust me? That's the one thing he asks of us. Will you trust me? Will you follow me and believe in me? When you get a prophetic word or a promise, you're not always told the how or the when. That's a little mystery right there. All you know is that it will. So the enemy will want to come in there and mess with you in the realm of the how. I'm not sure this is how it's going to happen or how. I don't even know if it can happen. That's the doubt of the enemy. Or the when. Okay, it's probably never going to happen. You've been years believing this. Those are both lies of the devil, challenging the solid word of God. And we've got to be strong. And it's okay if we've doubted and have those moments. I've had those moments a lot. But God restores me and helps me to keep my eyes on the promise of what he said. So this is Genesis 15. There's a few chapters down. Now for Abraham, life has progressed quite a bit. And he's been through a lot of things, and yet he's childless. He's served God. He's been faithful with God. He's tied the tenth of this massive spoil from a war he was in with the people of Sodom and all these different kings. And the kings want to like load him up with wealth. He's like, no, I can't do that. Lest you say when I'm blessed at the end of the day, because I know the promise on my life, that you did it. I won't take your money. God did it. So God meets him after the spoil. It's Melchizedek we talked about a few weeks ago. And he gives him a tenth of everything he has. That's the tithe again. That's the offering unto this guy. And then Melchizedek blesses him. And that's the first communion we see of bread and wine being taken. It's amazing what happens in that moment. But even after all those things, this is what Abraham says, or Abram at the time. Genesis 15, 1 through 6. After these things, the word of the Lord came to Abram in a vision, saying, do not be afraid, Abram. I am your shield, your exceedingly great reward. But Abram said, Lord God, what will you give me, seeing I go childless still? And the heir of my house is Eliezer of Damascus. You don't even have the same town. I mean, then Abram said, look, you've given me no offspring, Indeed, one born in my house is my heir. He was born there. Maybe that's what you're saying. Right? Where's the helping God out with this promise part we come up with? Continue. And behold, the word of the Lord came to him saying, this one shall not be your heir, but one who will come from your own body shall be your heir. Then he brought him outside and said, look now toward heaven and count the stars, if you are able to number them. It's another encounter. It's another vision. It's another moment with Jesus, refreshing your vision, refreshing the promise. And he said to him, so shall your descendants be. And he believed God. And he counted it to him for righteousness. See, righteousness in the kingdom is way more than your rights and wrongs. It's your trusting in Jesus. It's your confidence in his work. That's what we give him back. Will he do what he said he'd do? Will you believe that he'll do it? Will you hang on? God is faithful. So three temptations that we'll face in the fire of delay on our life when these promises aren't there yet. How many promises are you guys hanging on to this morning? Come on. We need some prophecy. We'll prophesy over you guys. But you have promises. They're precious and exceedingly great promises from the Father, just for you. And the Father is saying that to you today. I'm faithful. I'm a faithful Father. And I'm going to get you through this, and you're going to get to your promise. First one is questioning God's promise. That's what Abram struggled with. Where is it, God? You see, I go childless. I have this guy in my house from Damascus named Eleazar. You probably didn't even get to name him. He was born in my household, but is that the one then? Maybe that's what you had. It's a little gimmick at the end of the day. You just kind of slipped it in through this other guy. As great as this guy probably was. But God said, no, that's not it. Don't form your life around a substitute promise that didn't come the way I said. That's not the one. I told you what I said, and I mean it. It's going to come through your body. So questioning God's promise on us. Avoid, if you go to that place of where is it, tell God, be honest about it. But let him refresh you that it's exactly the way he said. Number two, downgrading the promise is the other temptation. Okay? This is what God must have meant. It's kind of one of the same as the first one. It's Eleazar. Because he's got to be. You know, I can't have kids. I'm like 75. I'm struggling with that. I'm 80 now. I mean, it's not even good to have kids old. My wife laughed when I said that. You know, but anyway, so I'm going to downgrade it to make it Eleazar, and I'll get behind that. I'll bless it. I'll be excited about that. Lord, if you want me. No, it's not that. Again, don't accept any substitutes. Don't downgrade your promise and make it fit something because you haven't seen the full manifestation yet. It is coming. And number three, probably the hardest crucible, is to begin to take over the promise God's made over your life and make it happen by your flesh. Abraham stumbled there big time. If Abraham had stumbled, man, who are we? You know, he is the father of the faith. But he stumbled because he began to rationalize and get into his mind, thinking the way God wants to bring it is probably not the way it's going to happen. But guess what? I can make it happen. And it still fits the general promise of what he said. I'll still have a seed through me, but it just won't be the ordained way. So he moved into a realm through bad counsel to produce and generate, to manufacture the promise outside of the waiting on the Lord. And it cost him severely. That son we know is Ishmael. Ishmael is what we believe is possibly the Antichrist line. Okay? Now God loves the children of Ishmael. He provided, he has a covenant promise for them. Through Abraham, if they'll turn to Christ, they will be saved. It's like all of us, obviously. But this line's been enacted. And why? And you've got to note this mystery. Because when God puts a promise and a mandate on your life, it's going to happen. And all the fullness of that blessing and authority will rest on whatever happens. So if we choose to go outside of the waiting and God's process to release the seed in which all the families of the earth will be blessed, and we go the flesh route, you'll birth an anti-type. because a promise is already there. And so when you get a promise, you need to steward it with sobriety and confidence so that it, when it comes forth, it's blessed and holy, okay? So that's the thing we need to watch out, taking over the promise. I'm going to take it in my own strength and make this happen for God. And it seems right because God said he's going to do this, but it wasn't his way, nor was it how he said he was going to do it. So avoid that like the plague. Any rate, I feel like some of us are kind of in the middle of promises. Probably all of us are at some point. You know, we're not dead. You know, we're all contending. We're all going for it. But I want to encourage you this morning that Father is good and he loves you. And his word you can trust. He's not like man that he should lie. What he has told you in your heart is going to manifest. My question to you is, can you endure the wait? Can you trust him? You know what happens in the waiting? You get prepared to steward what's coming. You get the character and the integrity build out, muscle build, to actually carry that amount of influence and authority. If you don't believe me, ask Joseph. Joseph knew from the beginning he was going to reign and his brothers were going to bow down to him and his mom and dad. But guess what? He went through trial and tribulation and the testing, the waiting of that promise until he got to a position of authority. And if he hadn't learned how to walk through those valleys and those trials with God, what would he have done when he had authority and the brothers who really messed him up came in front of him asking for help? He would have nixed them just like that. Set up. Maybe God wants me to. His second in command said, whatever you want me to do it. I'll take care of him right now. And Joseph breaks and he walks to the Lord and says, you know what? It's for this purpose I've come. It's not to get vengeance on you guys. It's to come set you free and to bring a blessing. And that's why you're bowing down. This is God. This is Christ in me. That's Jesus on the cross. I could call down 12,000 angels and finish this. But this is why I've come, to forgive you. To bring you, the ones who have brought me here to this moment in the cross, to bring you back. And I choose forgiveness. I choose to love you and to cry out for Father to forgive you. That's why I'm here. And that's the character being built back in all of us when we get the promise and that authority and power. Will we forgive and will we love? So next week we're going to talk about the rewards of enduring the promise and what happens when the promise finally shows up. Okay? And how you'll be blessed walking in that. So again, endure, trust the Lord, and know confidently he's building you right now to steward what he's about to send you. And trust him with the timing. Give him that. I trust you with the timing. I want it tomorrow. Who doesn't? That's the microwave mentality of our generation. Instant satisfaction, right? Be one who waits patiently for the promises, right? Good. And then you'll be ready to steward it. And it'll be a huge blessing. So let's just bow our heads and pray. Father, we thank you this morning for your word. We thank you, Jesus, for calling each of us, Lord. You call us by name, and you give us wonderful, exceedingly great promises, Lord. And I bless every promise resting in this room, Lord. Oh, we need them, Father. We want to see an explosion of revival, an explosion of awakening, an explosion of blessing of God upon our families and our generation, Lord God. And you're putting promises on each of us, Lord, to begin to work out your master plan. To harvest the nations. So Lord, I thank you and I plead the blood of Jesus over every promise this morning. I pray grace for everyone hearing, Lord, that we would walk patiently with you, trusting you, not forsaking, not growing frustrated by our flesh, but trusting that you're good and you're going to manifest it in the perfect time, in the fullness of time. So I thank you, Lord. We bless you. We pray in Jesus' holy name. Amen. Hallelujah. Okay, good. By the way, just a couple announcements. We have AV back there. Mike, raise your hand. Everyone knows Mike. If you are interested in like helping in the AV side, and you know, we're just kind of a growing ministry now, but we'll probably get more. That's a great way to serve and help out. And we could really use that. It'd be awesome. So talk to Mike. He can train you and help you. It's really good. And you can be around all the cool music. And like, basically, we call that little area like the bridge of the Enterprise, because it's like you can drive all the sound and equipment. You know, USS Enterprise. All right, I may have missed people. Star Trek generation. Thank you. Okay, come on. Be me aboard. Amen. Good. And happy Father's Day out there. Yeah. Spend time. Call your dads today. Love them. Bless them. You know, let them know you love them. They're not perfect. Our Heavenly Father's perfect. But let's love them and choose to forgive. and choose to bless and say thank you for the gold you did do. And some of you, that's hard because your fathers weren't always there, maybe never there. But can release a fragrance of just, I forgive them, I want to pray for them. And you will be moving in that integrity. It's powerful. Hallelujah. All right. Anything else? No, we're good. Okay. Music. Awesome, brother. Love you guys. See you next week. If you want prayer for anything, come on up. You can. I'll pray for you. But I feel like that was just kind of what God wanted to do today. Just encourage you in your faith. Right where you're at. Amen. Awesome. Allison, come on up.